thanks for coming and for writing and compiling this book. And it's great.
I like it.
I did like it. I didn't get all the way through it, but I got about halfway, and I like it a lot. So these are sayings of Paul Brunton. I know most of you didn't have a chance to buy the book. Did we bring books?
Yeah, I have some in the back of my car if you want to buy one.
Okay,
at a discount price of $12.
What's the full list price?
$15.
Oh. Sorry, you can't set up. So it's really a good little book. This is a compilation of quotes from Paul Brunton. And do you want to say, why don't you just give us a little background of what led you to put this together?
Well, Paul Brunton was a big teacher with our group up in Ithaca, my group. And after he died, he willed his materials to the group, and so he had these tons of notes, which, you know, everybody in the group worked on and processed and produced like 16 volumes of the best of these notes of Paul Brunton. So that series of books came out in the 80s. So I was working in town and taking the bus every day. So I would read the notebooks on the bus. So I managed to make it through them a couple of times. And to my surprise, there was this material on the short path, which I really liked and really resonated with, that really isn't in his published works. And so time went on, and eventually I came up with a internet listserv called Wisdom Hell. And I would post a quote a day from Paul Brunton. And at that time, I happened to get into Eckhart Tolle and The Power of Now, and I really saw that these quotes on the short path were just what Eckhart Tolle and Ajahshanti and all this current wave of teachers were saying. So, and then the publisher here, the guy who made the book, Larson Publications, Randy Cash, asked me to put together a bunch of quotes for a possible publication on, you know, basically the non-dual view. And so I did that, and then he decided there wasn't enough money in it, that even with the big authors outside of Eckhart Tolle, the Gandhiji and Ajahshanti really weren't selling that many books, or Jed McCann. So he dropped the project, and then the Paul Brunton Philosophical Foundation was fishing around a couple of years ago for something to publish, and so I suggested it, and I took a look at it, and they agreed to publish it. And so I had a number of editors along the way, and finally the Coxes, Jeff and Christy Cox, came up with this really good way of arranging the paragraphs in a coherent fashion, and the book is semi-published. This is the pre-publication copy. It's really coming out next month.
Originally, Dodger's quote about the book.
Oh, yeah.
It's really quite superb.
Paul Brunton gives voice to the profound teachings of immediate spiritual awakening that have the power to short-circuit the seeker in us and to reveal the true nature of reality here and now. The true gift of this wonderful book is in how nuanced and subtle Paul Brunton understood these profound and transformational teachings and how directly he conveys them. Read this book as you would a scripture or a sutra and let it open your eyes to eternity. That's great. And Gangaji also said something. The Short Path to Enlightenment is a deeply supportive text from the extraordinary Paul Brunton, a spiritual explorer who first brought knowledge of Ramana Maharshi to the West. In this work, readers receive the invitation and instruction to discover the truth of oneself. This book is alive with supreme knowledge. May it support you in immediately and continually recognizing yourself. So Paul Brunton was famous for, he wrote this book called Search and Secret India in the 30s, I think, but introduced Ramana to the West. And that's what she said about.
And you met him at Wisdom's Golden Rod. He came once or twice?
Once, 1977.
1977.
And he was there for a couple of weeks. And you had a personal interview with him. And it was interesting. Actually, that was the first intimation I had of the short path. It was the strange incident at the end where these people were. A couple came and they had two small kids and they were like pounding on the door. So he sort of looked up at the noise at the door and I just like grok how he was coming from like complete silence and complete sort of innocence. Like it wasn't. So, and that was my first real intuition of what the realization was like. And from that, my interest in the short path evolved. I tried to back.
Do you want to try to give us a description of what the short path is? Because you understand it. Or?
The short path?
Go for it.
Read this book.
You're the man.
Well, I like the... There's different aspects of the short path. I like the one where Brunton says it's a 180-degree turnaround from the long path. In other words, with a long path, you're concerned with your development, you're concerned with being a better person, resolving your complexes, you know. Whereas the short path, you sort of turn right around and turn directly to the light of consciousness or the light of awareness or the aliveness that you are. And you sort of give over those other issues to contemplation or remembrance of that, you know, sort of illuminative principle that you normally just take for granted, you don't really recognize.
Mark, would you read one of your sort of favorite-ish quotes from the book that give us a sense?
Sure,
of what
I brought a bunch actually. Well, this one's pretty famous. There's no real ego, but only a quick succession of thoughts which constitute the I process. There's no separate entity forming the personal consciousness, but only a series of impressions, ideas, images revolving around a common center. The latter is completely empty. The feeling of something being there derives from a totally different plane, that of the over-self, which is what you could say. The term today is consciousness or awareness, or over self, higher self, the self, or
no self.
Or no self, depending on if you're a potato or Zen.
Do you think
so? Do all these words mean the same thing? All of them? I mean, they're used interchangeably, but you mean consciousness, awareness, over
yeah.
self, all of them mean the same
I mean, thing? I would say so, yeah.
In this context, yes.
Do you think some people would use the word soul as the over self?
Yeah, I think so. If it's, the way Brunton uses it sometimes is in a very sort of a dualistic way where you pray to your over-self or you seek inspiration from your over-self or the over-self is like an overseeing, you know, formless personality of your life. That, I would say, is soul, but I also think there's a distinction there between soul and self. Because the soul incarnates, right? The self
yeah.
doesn't incarnate, so it doesn't reincarnate.
If it, I mean, the over self, you know, as no mind or as no self, as I understand it, would be completely impersonal. There'd be nothing personal about it. And yet it's manifest in a personal way by me or you. So the way the over self is shown in the world by me is different than it would be by you. But the and it's not an entity, so there's nothing you can really say about it. Mm-hmm. But it's exactly like my understanding of no mind, mm-hmm. or emptiness, or awareness, or just this. This. So.
Or as Dasa Davidson said, "You're the context, not the content." So I like it.
If I say something that doesn't fit Paul Brunton's idea, tell me.
Okay.
I'm not a Brunton expert, but that's
no. That fits right in with what this is exactly addresses your point.
Right.
So sometimes it's contextual. Sometimes the over-self is soul, and sometimes it's the higher self or awareness or consciousness. Let's see. Here's another good quote. Although the over-self does not pass through the diverse experiences of its imperfect image, the ego, nevertheless, it witnesses them. Although it is aware of the pain and pleasure experienced by the body which it is animating, it does not itself feel them. Although detached from physical sensations, it is not ignorant of them. On the other hand, the personal consciousness does feel them because it regards them as states of its own self. Thus, the over-self is conscious of our joys and sorrows without itself sharing them. It is aware of our sense experience without itself being physically sentient. Those who wonder how this is possible should reflect that a man awakened from a nightmare is aware once again, in the form of a revived memory, of what he suffered and what he sensed, and yet does not share again either the suffering or the sensations. So this is the over-self as the witness consciousness of your experience. And, you know, basically since it is the consciousness, it's available in every act of your experience, but it doesn't, it animates and knows, but it doesn't, you know, feel with the same directness as the ego going through its existence. And I don't know, you know that when you're in a crisis and you're really miserable and you're wringing your hands, and sometimes you get a break just for a moment. You see, like, oh, hey, there's something really going on here. It's just this guy wringing his hands. You know, and then you're back in the ego. But if it wasn't for this higher self, which does not, you know, then that wouldn't be possible. You couldn't be free of those things. Anyway, free. So I like that one. Here's another one. The source of wisdom and power, of love and beauty, is within ourselves, but not within our egos. It is within our consciousness. Indeed, its presence provides us with a conscious contrast, which enables us to speak of the ego as if it were something different or apart. End of part. It is the true self, whereas the ego is only an illusion of the mind. So it's a little bit more, it brings up a few more aspects than it's just sheer witness and sheer awareness, that really it's the object of your desires, behind your activities in life, behind your relationships. You're always really seeking to commune with this higher self, but it's masked by, you know, the content of your experience.
Masked by your interest in the content and your identification with it.
Yeah.
I mean, content does not need to mask anything. It just is. But if you believe you are that content, then you reify it or make it real in a way that it is. It's just like light and shadows.
Yeah. I was, lately I've been thinking about this, who is it that says intimacy with the 10,000 things? That's them saying...
Dogen.
Dogen. So, intimacy is interesting because it's a characteristic of realization that isn't often brought out. It's sort of a I mean, everybody accentuates the freedom from psychology and the ego, but this intimacy with love and beauty and wisdom is another aspect of self, of realization of the no-mind.
That to me is a hallmark or characteristic that isn't always described or discussed, but real presence means real intimacy. And it means no buffers, no barriers, no numbing, no separation. I mean, it's intimacy to the point that there's really no me and you. But at another level, you recognize there's two people, but it's that's what oneness means. That you can feel what other people feel. You're not separate from them in a fundamental way. So judgment tends to diminish when you're seeing things that way.
Yeah, and the intimacy is nice. I mean, it's not like science or something, the cold facts or whatever. You know, it's really the sense of well-being and sense of compassion or.
But it's a felt experience. I mean, it's in the body, and it's felt through sensation and feeling. So it's not a thought, it's an experience, experiential reality, intimacy with everything. So there was a Zen master who said he was meditating, and he looked and saw a morning glory open in the morning, and he said he was startled. He was startled. And that's intimacy, that's presence. I said, wow. To be startled by something, or seeing a spider web, really seeing it. It's really seeing what's there without all the mind layers upon layers of interpretation and naming. I mean, even thinking, what a beautiful spider web, or what a beautiful morning glory, is already a separation. Just this. And nothing added to it. It's what I call pure perception or direct seeing. But it's not just seeing, it's experiencing with all the senses. Just this, but really this. And this is like the poem, a beautiful poem from Galway Canal, where he says, all I want is what I want. But that, just that. What I want is. What I want. But that, I really want that. But I really want that. But just that. Nothing else. Nothing extra. Nothing laid on top of it. And if you see the way your mind normally works, it's always laying things on top of your experience. By naming it, by interpreting it, by thinking about it, by everything you do all day. It separates you, from your direct experience. And if you look closely at the one having that experience, there's no one there. There's no entity of the you, but there is an experience that's real. Experience is happening. It's being felt by a body and lived in this moment.
Sometimes it happens when you first hear a piece of music, but you don't know what the composer is, or you don't know what the piece of music is, so you completely hear it without any conceptualization. It just sounds so amazing. Like, you wonder, what is this? This is
right. In Zen, it's called beginner's mind. Seeing something for the first time is if you, and that could be seeing your wife or your husband or your dog or your car, seeing it without any conditioning. And I mean, very simply, the long path is removing conditioning, one step at a time. The short path is seeing through it immediately and directly.
Right. Well, the long path is based on wanting to get somewhere other than here, wanting to get somewhere else in the future.
Yes.
Just endless.
Well, you want to make yourself worthy either to be on the quest or to be in love, get self-realization or get some act of grace or something, and you really feel like, you know, your raw material, you really got to work on it. You got to be. You find your feelings, yeah. You find your thinking.
And we're so conditioned, you know, from especially from the school system. Start in kindergarten, you go first grade, second, then you go to high school, and then you go to college and grad school, and then you get your job. Then there's the career ladder.
It's also all religious practice is the long path, by definition, pretty much. Unless you're maybe in a Zen session and you're going right at it. But, I mean, I had this experience. I went up to see Pino Rinpoche, who has, he's dead now, but he had this center just in north of Green, New York. Is everybody familiar with that? It's a wonderful place.
I think I went there once for some Tibetan dances.
Yeah, in mid-August, they have a Sunday when it's open to the public, and they do Tibetan dances. Now, I don't know if it happens to be today or next week, but it's right around this time. But I went up at that time, and they have a lot of Tibetan lamas and rinpoches and people from all over the world that study there in the summer. And I have never really been that taken personally by Tibetan Buddhism, although I feel a resonance. I feel some resonance deeply, but the practice of it never really appealed to me. And so I was talking to people.
Why would it appeal to me? First, you're going to learn Tibetan, you've really got to go do all this.
I don't know why it appeals to me, but it does appeal to a lot of people. But I found some Americans there and spoke English, and I asked them, so tell me, what is your understanding of your Tibetan Buddhist practice? And I met this woman who's very articulate and had been there, been deeply immersed in this stuff for years and years. And the gist of it, and I hope I'm not, I don't mean to make fun, but it's like you purify yourself for the next 20 incarnations. Right. And maybe then you have the chance to go for awakening. And I thought, whoa. There is no way. That is not appealing. And you know, it's such a contrast to the Zen practice that I did, which from the first moment of a retreat, you are shoved as hard as you can into emptiness. And so, but these people, and I'm not saying there isn't value in this very slow, methodical practice of undoing bad karma, doing good deeds. That's like, to me, the quintessential long path. But all religious traditions are teaching that. Everything. Yes?
Well, Tibetan Buddhism has various aspects for those people, you know, who's not familiar with it. I mean, there is a short path version called Dzogchen.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've heard
of
that.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
Yeah, I mean, sure, Tibetan Buddhism has, you know, purification and transformation,
yeah,
like, you know, like any other thing does, but the you know, has that direct, that focus too.
Right. And I'm not saying it's not worthwhile. I mean, a lot of the stuff I did and do and have done and still do was long path stuff. I mean, it really was. It was, you know, it felt that way. Sitting through 7-day retreats felt like a kind of purification. It did. It felt like habits and conditioning were rubbing off. And a lot of the teaching, a lot of the psychotherapy, a lot of the constellation work that we do now is meant to do that. So it's not to, in any way, diss the long path. It's just, how long does that have to be? I don't know. But,
until you get
to
the short path.
But?
Until you get to the short path.
Until you get to the short path. And he has some nice quotes in here about when you transition. But most people who start are going to start with a long path, I think.
Yeah.
And that's fine. That the point of the long path is to make you less miserable and less crazy, and more able to be present enough to actually, I would say, this is my language now, stop thinking long enough that maybe something clicks. You know, maybe grace has a shot at you. As long as you're as obsessive and preoccupied and self-absorbed as most people are, you're not going to have much of a chance. The short path isn't going to do anything.
Right, you can't take young men in their 20s who are getting interested in spirituality and path and tell them it's nothing you have to do, you're already as enlightened as you're going to get.
Yeah, I mean, having studied PB's works as long as you have as well, and having met him, I mean, my understanding of long and short paths, they're actually kind of intertwined. I mean, you don't even embark upon a long path unless you have some aspiration.
Right.
Okay. And that aspiration, you know, frequently, although not always, but, you know, has to do with some kind of intuition, you know, into whatever you want to call it, you know, either the One or God or,
yeah,
you know, whether it's vague or whatever. Yeah. So, I mean, your long path activities are fueled, you know, by your aspiration, which has to do with some kind of insight, and it's not A and B. And what I understand and meaning by the short path, it's still a path, actually. It's not awakening. Short path is not awakening. It could lead to awakening, okay? But the short path is focusing more on your, you know, let's say the ideal. You know, it's focusing more on the one, more on the self, more on consciousness, God, whatever you want to call it. So instead of like, okay, we're going to work on me, going to work on me, going to work on me, it's like focus, okay, just on that, and you know, however different many ways, whatever. But it's still an activity. Mm-hmm. It's still a remembrance. You might have had an insight. You might have had an intuition. You might have had, you know, a samadhi or something. And it's, you know, remembering that. PB talks about this in a number of different ways. Right. The short path is not awakening itself. Could lead to it.
Right.
But so I'm saying, you know, they're intertwinable. Mm-hmm. You don't go on the short path to do that with the long path.
Well, if you go through
personality still could need some work.
PB says like every possible relationship between the two. I mean, he'll say you have to run the two concurrently, and they'll say no, you have to completely drop the long path and take the short path. I mean, he just says every possible, because I think it depends on who you are and where you're at, yeah. Basically.
Don't you think that every person's path toward being is distinct? As individual, I mean, each path is
sure. Yeah.
We have generalities we can share that are helpful, but the specifics is a separate for each of us, not separate.
I think he's really got a genius for description and categorization and explanation. I mean, you're right, though. I mean, what people actually do is both of these. But he's got an ability to observe and describe. It's really very good. Articulate. He's a professional writer.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Everything remembered is a thought in consciousness. This not only applies to objects, events, and places, it applies also to persons, including oneself, who is he who is remembered, the I that I was. This means that my own personality, what I call myself, was a thought in the past, however strong and however persistent. But the past was once the present. Therefore, I am not less a thought now. The question arises, what did I have then, which I still have now, unchanged, exactly the same? It cannot be the I as a person, for that is different in some way each time. It is, and can only be, I as consciousness. So this is really a sort of a reformulation of a kind of standard Hindu explanation, which is, you know, you were a small child, you were a teenager, you were, you know, in your 20s and getting married and getting a job, and you're in your 40s and you're in your 50s. And you've gone through all these changes, but what's the same? You're the same. You the person. You the awareness that's having, you what's directly present right here. Is the same. So it's one of the, you know, adages they use to point to what they're talking about, which is basically you, what you really are.
Not only that, but that same awareness in you is also the same awareness that's in everyone else.
Right, right. So there's another one, a story that the Hindus tell to point to self-realization, which is the 10 brothers that go hunting for tigers. So the 10 brothers go out on a hunting expedition. They're hunting for tigers, and one stops and he counts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Oh no, one of them's been eaten, one of them got killed by a tiger. And the next one down does the same thing. Yeah, you're right, you know. One of us is missing. So they all go around, and then they go back to see their father. He says, you forgot to count yourself. So the point being is that what these people are pointing to is what is present right now, What is illuminating your experience? What is knowing your experience? What's here now, not home, watching sports on TV or something? More than one. You are this clear, open, aware space. You're the subject that everything is happening in. Oh, that's how I'm thinking of it later, anyway. So, Elliot, you were saying you liked one of his paras about humor?
Yeah, there was one of the quotes I read in the first half, that the long path is humorless. You know, I was serious about, well, I've got to get enlightened, I've got to, you know, I've got to get it, I've got to achieve liberation, I've got to do it, you know, become a holy person, you know, a really spiritual being.
Got to suffer.
Yeah. And it's like, well, maybe you should go see a movie. You know, you think we're taking this whole thing a little too seriously. So the long path, there's this ego that's, you know, directed and willed in a certain direction and forgets just to, you know, relax and have and experience just the joy of being. So one of PB's quotes has, you know, the fact that the long path can be very humorless, in that, you know, you want to get somewhere, the Western mentality, I gotta make it, I gotta have a glimpse of God, you know. I saw it on Oprah. That's what I want.
Well, I don't know, my own spiritual path, you know, I started when I got out of college. I was in my early 20s, and so what we did was we'd read, you know, a couple hours and meditate and concentrate, and we were all vegetarians, and we didn't drink, and we didn't smoke, and we didn't fully smoke, but cigarettes.
Funny cigarettes.
We didn't smoke funny cigarettes. And anyway, so then there came a time when Paul Brunton came to visit. And 2 months before his visit, I was in this major car wreck. I was in the hospital for a month. And my roommate died in the car accident. I had this near-death experience. And that was nice. But later, when I met Paul Brunton, I realized that the car wreck was necessary. Because all of that hard work and concentration was just building up this huge armoring of directed intention. And that actually what I needed was to have that completely taken away, you know, and be in a passive condition where I would be able to say, you know, receive something from Brunton's presence or get something out of it. So very often, so that says something about the difference between the long and the short path. You know, the long path can be too directed, too conscious, too ego-controlled, too evaluated, too much thought about. Whereas really, what's being called for on the short path is a receptive attitude. One where, you know, your inner teacher knows what's best, you know. And you might not even know what you're doing, but that's okay.
Elliot, in 1971, PB said, we were in Switzerland, consciousness is funny.
Consciousness is what?
Consciousness is funny, quote unquote.
But he didn't explain that?
No, he didn't go into that, but he did smile.
Well, I have to, in India, James Swartz, who's originally American, but he spent a lot of time in India teaching Vedanta, his Indian name is Ramji. He's now living in Spain. Anyway, I asked him that humor. He says, well, he points up on his chart, he points to the awareness at the very top. And he was talking about the gunas, and I'll make this really short. The Rajas, Tamas, and Sattva, the three energies. Anyway, he says, but awareness, that's the humor guna. Because from awareness, everything is funny. From the point of view of supreme awareness, everything is humorous. Mm-hmm. You can't take it seriously.
And there's a certain kind of humor to the when we realize that we're in this predicament of being in a human body and we have to live in this world, and at the same time we have certain awarenesses where we realize a lot of what we participate in is kind of a sham that we just have to do in order to be in a body.
Yeah,
and there's, you know, periodically that seems kind of funny. when you look at it a certain way.
Is that, you know, I guess I'm really, that's, I'm kind of wrestling with that right now. Is it really true that the sort of, like, your body, being in a body has, sort of implicates the relativity? I mean, or is it, well, can you really feel free in your body?
I'm not the one to answer.
No, I guess I was just kind of wondering.
I think you can feel free.
Yeah.
If you look at it from the perspective where it's kind of funny, there's paradoxes all over the place, and they don't have to be resolved.
Well, what kind of freedom are you looking for?
I guess the embodiment of being free in the world, of awareness, the embodiment of it, so that you actually you're feeling free through your body, through it, rather than feeling like trapped in your body as a relative, like finite creature. So awareness is moving through your body, through, but it's awareness rather than, you know, what I guess it made me think about was I'm the sense that I have is that I still feel encumbered by this body.
In what way?
What?
In what way?
In what way? It's like there's a very deep knowing that there is no self. That there is, it's a fiction. The self that we think is a fiction. Especially when I have to engage more in the world, in everyday activity, which I would prefer not to, but what, you know, you're saying that, you know, you're sort of encouraged to. I feel the body, the activity sort of is just doesn't feel the same as when I can just embrace being awareness. It's just a funny, it's a feeling that I don't feel free. It's hard to keep embodying awareness in daily activity.
My only thought of this is that when you're meditating, you're still in the body, but what is the body? The body is just this vast, dark emptiness that's confronting you in meditation. So, I mean, we conceive of the body as you know, having a look and our fingers and nerves and stuff like that. But really, it's just this vast emptiness, and there's an occasional sensation drifting across it, like I have an itch in my foot or something, you know. So, I would say that's my read on the body.
But what about when you have to get up?
Get up and go to work.
Yeah, and go to work. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure my sense is that the awareness, you sort of, there is a sense of maintaining awareness at moment to moment, and that so your body has it's your relation to your body or the relations kind of shifts. So that's my sense. But I can meditate and sense what you're, you know, being awareness. And I could stay there all day.
Right.
I think I am anyway. I don't know. Who knows? Maybe I'm not. You know, it's like the absence of anything else, anything that sort of temporal.
Draws you out.
That's what it's appearing as right now.
I always wish, I think I know what you're saying, because when I would read text about Zen, and they talk about, you know, enlightenment as chop wood, cured water, and I would like to live in the world feeling, but I think that's what all this is about, is getting where you are present, and you do have, because I'm like you, I get into work and it all goes out the window, you know.
Yeah. It's a lot easier to get a sense of what this is all about in some kind of silence or stillness or retreat. He mentions that in the book, but retreats are very helpful. getting out of your normal activities, meaning out of your normal conditioning. Most of us are completely conditioned. And that's, we're taught that you should, you know, you should think, you should worry, you should obsess, you should ruminate, you should try to control things. And so we do that. And, you know, if you have little glimpses, it's usually going to be when you're not having to do something else. When you have silence, like in meditation or walking through the woods or playing with a dog or something that you're not thinking you have to be responsible. And it's a lot easier to be present at those times. But then once you get some sense of that, and it usually happens at those times when you're not having to do something, then how can you take that awareness and live it out in daily life all the time? And you can, but it's hard to, he talks about remembering what it feels like is a helpful practice. Remembering it when you were silent and you were still and you didn't have to make decisions at work or argue with your wife or tell your kid what to do. So there's a lot. Yeah, the answer is you can do that. You can live in the body and be free. But you can have a job and be free. You can live in the real world and be free. But this is not easy to do. And there's a whole kind of practice that comes after even the deepest awakening at what is now usually called embodiment, or the ability to manifest this emptiness in the world of form, responsibility, pressures, decision making, judgments, people criticizing you. How do you stay in that presence when so much conditioning and programming is sort of calling you back into being a conditioned robot? Right? That's your question. It's a challenge.
It's like being in the eye of a storm, just a quiet,
right,
still place in the center of chaos.
Yes.
Well, Brunton gives a couple of exercises. One is called the remembrance exercise, where
it's a very good one.
You simply remember a glimpse what you had, but you remember it to sort of invoke it in your daily activities. It's like bringing in a higher point of view. And the other one is called the as-if exercise, which is you go about your business as if you're enlightened, basically. As if you've already got it. And fake it till you make it.
Can I read a real short one? I keep turning to
please.
It, and I like it. It's under the insight heading. Chapters, experiences along the way. In this astonishing revelation, he discovers that he himself is the seeker, the teacher, and the sought-for goal.
And the what?
The sought-for goal. Like
that. Yeah, it's nice.
There's a quote he has where he says, recognition. Recognition is a prominent feature on the short path. The over-self is always there, but only those on the short path recognize this truth and think accordingly. The world is always with us, but only those on the short path recognize the miracle that it is. In moments of exhilaration, uplift, awe, satisfaction, thousands of people have received a glimpse, but only those on the short path recognize it for what it really is. So recognition is really a big deal. In fact, I remember reading one person who was very famous, and I don't remember who it was, someone like Ajahn, but I don't think it was him. I think it was a Zen master, who was saying that one of the main focus of a teacher is to recognize this awareness when it shows up in the student, and then to help the student see it. So, and this is something that I think this is a really good comment, because it's always showing up. But we don't see it. It always is occurring, but we're missing it. Why? Because we're so consumed with our own thoughts and beliefs and opinions and judgments and convictions and worries and fears and self-absorption that we don't see what's right here, right now. This is always, this over-self is always right here. Can't be anywhere else. Doesn't go away. But we don't see it. And, you know, something I've learned 5-6 years ago, and I do a lot, is when I hear the slightest glimpse of acting without thinking, or speaking without thinking, or what I call acting or speaking out of no mind, which you would say the yoga self, I point that out to people, because they don't usually see it, because we're not trained to see it. We're not encouraged to see it. We're not taught to recognize this spontaneous emergence in our own life. And it happens to all of us all the time. But the thinking mind doesn't see it, because it happens sort of like outside of that. It happens of its own. So it's sort of like the thinking mind doesn't notice the eruptions of this direct awareness into your daily life. So learning to recognize it is really very, very useful. You see? Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
See, it seems like it goes together. This is the thing that I wonder about, is that you can have that sense of awareness always. Mm-hmm. It's always there. But then the engagement in the world seems to activate the thinking mind, and then it seems like that the conditioning that is...
I understand. There's two things. One is you have a fundamentally different relationship to the thinking mind. The thinking mind occurs, but it's only engaged in for things that are useful and beneficial. And the thinking mind is very, very useful for many things. But it's not used to ruminate, obsess, and worry, which is the vast majority of what most of us call thinking. It's not thinking, it's worrying, ruminating, obsessing. So, but there's like an inner difference in the relationship with the thinking. You know, you don't take it so seriously. There's a lightness about it. So, yes, thinking happens, but worry and rumination doesn't. And so the inner experience of it is different. And you can take care of any responsibility in that way. Strangely enough, in a way it keeps surprising. But anything that needs to get done gets done the way I describe it, and most of you have heard me talk about it, out of no mind, or out of emptiness. There's a sense of, it's happening and this body is doing it, but there's no sense of, that I'm doing it. It's just occurring of its own. So whenever that's going on, whatever comes of that, it's going to be skillful and effective and powerful and direct. So you're asking, what's it like to live in the world, be responsible, work, you know, maybe have physical ailments, things go on. How do you do that and maintain a state of present awareness? And the answer is, you're not attached to any of it. You're there, but you're not doing it. It is doing it. He would say the over-self acts through you. And that's exactly what is happening. And that's actually what's happening all the time anyway to all of us. We just don't recognize it. Back to the recognition thing. That's really all that's happening. Everything else is just a fabrication.
Well, that's one of the key concepts of the short path, which is that what you want in spirituality is no longer some future goal that you're going to achieve 10 incarnations down the line. It's already present now. You want peace. Peace is here at this moment. You want to realize the self. The self is here, right here, at this moment. So it's a, you know, it's a complete knocking off of the temporal aspect mm-hmm. of spiritual seeking.
Or the sense of getting somewhere, or not getting somewhere. The people who talk about you're already awake are absolutely right. You are absolutely already awake. You already are the over self. You can't not be. That's your nature. You don't have to earn it or get it somehow or lose it either. You can't. It's impossible.
There's another quote, I think it was in this book by Paul Brunton, that said something like, stop looking for the over self.
Right.
And start realizing that it's already here.
That it's who you are. You're not separate from it. It's the same, you know, I think the over self concept and the idea of God would be fine. I mean, to me they're the same too. I don't know that you would see it, but to me it's, you know, you can't fall out of the grace of God, is the way it occurred to me at one point. You are not separate from God's grace. You can't be. It's impossible. You may think you have to earn it, or you can lose it. You cannot. It's impossible. It's your nature. It's your true nature. You just have to recognize it. And it's always been here. It never goes anywhere. You, when you, so to speak, find it, you haven't actually found anything that you weren't already. This is really true. So that's, to me, I suppose, the short path, the direct recognition of what is actually true.
Is it possible that the direct, like, I know that. I know that deeply. Mm-hmm. It's just...
Well, then you have to notice when you forget it. Notice when you forget it. And then come back to it. Come back to the remembrance. And he talks about remembering. It's a very beneficial practice.
Yeah. I mean, maybe that's just it. It's like just keep remembering. It's
just keep remembering. He comes. He says this. Come back to this over and over again. That is the practice of the short path. Okay. That's a. You know, you're right. It's a discipline. It's a practice. It's something you do. Mm-hmm. So come back to the remembrance and the recognition over and over and over.
Something about understanding versus experiencing. And I know there's a quote from Ramana Maharshi about dropping from the mind into the heart. He uses the word abashedly. That's interesting. But, you know, I can
always want experience.
Understanding. But that's understanding.
Understanding that's useful comes after experience.
Well, usually, Brunton says you need a serious glimpse, and not just a random glimpse. You need a glimpse, a specific kind of glimpse, to set out on the short path. And glimpse is usually into your own emptiness,
your own emptiness. Let's see. He says most people who start the short path have usually had a glimpse of the Oversoul, because otherwise they find it too difficult to understand what the short path is about. I think that's been my experience too. For me, I don't think I really could begin the long path in earnestness until I'd already had a glimpse. That was just...
The short path, you mean?
No, the long path. The disciplined practice. Like, how people do that without a glimpse is beyond me. I don't understand.
I
don't know why it appeals. Some people do. I've talked to people who do, but I don't get it. But like you said a minute earlier, most people who really throw themselves into this and are kind of smitten and can't not do it have had some kind of glimpse. Yeah. Why else would you do this? I don't know. It takes some kind of monumental faith that I never had. The faith that occurred in me was a result of experience. Then I had faith, because I knew for sure this is real. But I marvel. There are people who don't have that experience and yet practice. Like, wow. It's amazing. Somebody had a question.
Yes. Can you maybe give more examples or in general describe these glimpses that you said people miss a lot of times?
That they miss?
Yeah, the ones that you would point out.
The kind I point out are when people tell me something, and usually this is the context of psychotherapy, that they did or said, and I feel it instantly. They don't even have to tell me hardly anything, and I know it. And I help them see it. That felt different. That wasn't thought about first and then done. That occurred like boom. On its own. There's a totally different quality to the way we usually think we do things. So I help them see it by pointing it out and helping them see the results of it. The results of that action, which is a free action in the world, are always effective. They're always skillful. They're always couldn't be better. Like whatever is said or done out of that no mind has really good results. So part of the process is the recognition, the different quality of those actions, and the observation that they're always skillful and effective. In other words, developing recognition and then trust in this unfolding or this eruption of no mind. or the over-self. It's, we're afraid of it. We're afraid of being that free and spontaneous and direct. We're taught that you have to really, you know, sleep on things and be careful. And I mean, all of us all day are trying to be careful and control things we have no control over. And in this free action, there's no concern with that at all. There's just an immediate seeing. And it's a seeing that me, I'm not capable of. It's too direct and clear and perceptive. But you have all had experiences like this in your life. And if you stop and think about it for just a few minutes, you can begin to remember some of them, at least in childhood and probably as an adult. When you just did something without thinking and it was perfect. It was as good as it could have been. It was better than you would normally expect your actions to be, more skillful.
I think sometimes you don't notice it because it doesn't involve the eye. So the eye, ego isn't interested in it. But you kind of notice out of the corner of your eye, you actually benefited somebody through some interaction that you really didn't participate in at all. The eye could lay no claim to it, wasn't involved in it, didn't take a posture. So it doesn't have any interest for it. So that's how it's but should be pointed out.
That's exactly the way it is. The eye doesn't notice it because it wasn't the agent of it. And not only that, the eye isn't interested because it hasn't been taught to notice it. So when you can learn to notice these things, and they do happen for everybody. Small things. A moment your mind is silent and you're just looking. Now normally we don't notice that that's occurring. The me, the thinking mind. But you can learn to notice. It happens of its own. You don't do that. It's not like I'm going to sit here and be present. That's not how it works. The presence is already occurring. Now you can sort of distract yourself from it and not notice it, but it's already here. So you can learn to notice these things. It's what he means by recognition and then remembrance and then what I would call trust. You can trust this free movement. You can always trust it. But that goes against everything we're taught our whole life, that you have to be careful, you know, controlled. This is the opposite of control. This is surrender. This is what's meant by surrender. Surrender is, I mean, and you can use different language, but when Jesus talks about not my will, but thy will be done, this is what he means. Let me be an instrument of your will. It's the prayer of St. Francis. I have no will of my own. That's what that means. Yes?
Well, I just remembered an experience I had in high school before I had any exposure to any kind of things I would consider spiritual, but it was just this incident that seems remarkable. It seemed remarkable at the time, and in retrospect, it does. I was very withdrawn and never expressed anger because I was always afraid of what the response would be. And I was walking in the hallway in high school and a couple, boyfriend and girlfriend, friend of mine, were having some kind of argument. And it just seemed clear to me that it was a ridiculous argument. Mm-hmm. And I just kind of went off the edge. I started yelling at him and saying, this is ridiculous what you're doing. Mm-hmm. And the girl slapped me. And I felt perfectly fine about the whole thing.
Well, that sounds,
I felt like it was exactly what I was supposed to do.
That sounds like a good example. That's a good example. My teacher, Philip Caplow, used to give an example where he'd say, where is there more awakened awareness? You know, and he would demonstrate someone sitting in meditation. And then he would describe a bar fight where everybody is swinging and throwing beer bottles. Where is there more Zen? That was his question. Where is there more Zen?
The bar fight.
Nobody's thinking. Everybody's just... It's just movement. It's just spontaneous movement. And I didn't get that forever. I didn't understand why that would be the right
thing. So your next session, we're going to go to a bar?
That's another reason why a lot of people when they're drunk and they have horrible car accidents, they don't get hurt. You know?
Yeah.
You see this all the time. Anyway.
Angela, did you have anything to say?
I had a couple, I was writing them down so I forgot, but that's okay. I asked him about your session.
Go ahead.
Okay, so like you talked about a bar fight. You said it has a certain resonance to it, but a bar fight would probably have a lot more anger to it, right?
he was using it as an example of what I would now call no mind in action. It's spontaneous action without thought that is free. So, I mean, most people would come to it. This was during an initial workshop on Zen Buddhism. Most people think, you know, being in meditation is the right answer. Because their thinking mind's in charge. And they're trying to do what they think they should, come up with the right answer, blah, blah, blah. But it was a way of destabilizing people's automatic belief system. And it makes you think, a bar fight.
Yeah, I mean, you can't. If you're going to hit somebody over the head with a beer bottle, you can't think, well, I should hold it at 45 degrees, or maybe I should go on.
Right. I was listening to the radio yesterday, ESPN Sports Hour, something while I'm driving, and they were interviewing this guy who's a famous cornerback in the NFL. So, and the interviewer's saying, and he was talking about a particular quarterback who's very famous, like Tom Brady, I think. So when Brady stops, drops back, do you think I'm going to do this? He said, I'm not thinking. I'm just reacting. If you're thinking, you're way too slow. It's a really good answer. There's no thinking that going on here.
You know that.
This is instant reactivity, just like that.
You see that in athletics.
Yeah, you see it. I mean, it's the whole point with, you know, the samurai code. It's like just instant reaction with those swords.
Now, what I would probably end up doing is going, oh my God, anxiety would kick in and go, what do I do now? I don't want that to not happen. And then
that's an example of you being you, and that's how most of us are.
Well,
most
I know
of the
because
time.
Then the anxiety will come
but
in.
Notice the free action that occurs spontaneously in your life from time to time. It's happening. We aren't taught to notice it. He talks about recognition. It's important.
Is that how you would foster
it? Learn to see it.
Is that how you would foster
it? That's how you foster it. You recognize it. And then you remember it, and then you learn to trust it.
Because you can't make it happen.
You are not in charge of this. You don't do it. If you're doing it, it's not it.
Sometimes it'd be nice to happen when you needed it to happen.
Another thing my teacher said a long 30 years ago in a session was, if I do it, it's going to get screwed up. If I get out of the way and it just happens, then it'll be skillful. I didn't understand that either for the longest time, but this is what he was talking about.
I don't know if this is useful, Michael. I've just finished editing a book from an Indian, great Indian teacher. We talked about it on the way down in the car. And he distinguished the two kinds of minds, the functional mind and the struggling mind.
Struggling?
The struggling mind. The functional mind is what you're saying. When you're doing, we all have what he calls external things to do. We have to do things. We have to get things done. We've got to go to work. We've got to go to sleep, etc. When the mind is just naturally taking care of what needs to be done, mm-hmm. as the functional mind. Mm-hmm. But when the mind starts recycling on itself, then that becomes the struggling mind. And, mm-hmm. oh gee, why did I do that? Oh, right. I shouldn't have done that. Oh my God, I'm late. Oh, I'm going to miss the train. Anyway, you get it. But most of our problems, according to him, and I'm sure you probably would agree, are from the struggling mind. Mm-hmm. It's thoughts
all
about,
of it.
All of it. There you go.
That's all there is.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the only problem.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The fact that, not that the mind is doing that, that we're taking it seriously and identifying it.
Yes. And we're recycling, renewing, reviving, reactivating emotions with the struggling mind.
So if you can learn to watch that happen and not take it so seriously, you've already accomplished 50% of what you need to do. Just watching and observing is an automatic, I call it losing interest.
Yeah,
that helps you lose interest in it.
Yeah.
Normally we're totally preoccupied with all this stuff. Well, let me give you a quick example also of a guy that we talked about last time, this Japanese Zen master from 1750, Bankai. I sent out a link to his famous book on the unborn. But he was giving an example of this other knowing. I call it the other way of knowing. So it's like you're sitting here, you're listening to a talk, but there's cars going by on Riverside Drive. You don't have to think that's a car going by on Riverside Drive. You just know it. Something in you is just fully aware of that, right? and for some reason the car is bearing down on this office, lost control, you would know that. Something in you, you don't have to think about it. It knows. What knows? The Overself knows. Emptiness knows. No mind knows. But we don't notice that other knowing. We don't pay attention. Or you hear a bird call. You know it's a bird call. You know it doesn't need your attention, really. You don't need to call it anything. You don't need to think about it. You just know. That just knowing is always there. Normally driving is in the state of just knowing. A lot of what we do all day is in the same state of just, you just know, just do it. You don't have to think about it. And if you start thinking about it, you're going to mess it up. You know? Try to hit a golf ball and think about how you're swinging. It's not a good idea.
I've hit a few times where I'm done.
What's that?
I've hit a few times where I work from like the functioning mind and just mm-hmm. done something.
Right.
And it was perfect, but afterwards, even in those cases, mm-hmm. the mind starts saying, like, what the hell did
right.
I do? And
right.
suppose this would have happened, or that right. would have. Yeah, it's like you stop trust.
That's what I mean by trust.
Yeah.
When you can notice, pay attention and notice the results of action out of this no mind or over self, then you see for yourself, it works. It's fine. You can trust it. It has a different feel, a different quality, effortlessness. It doesn't take effort.
It's interesting, and there was, like when Adyashanti was in Ithaca in his day-long thing, he had an exchange with this guy, and the guy was talking about how now it's completely different. He waits for the intuition to come, and he follows the intuition, and sometimes there isn't an intuition. And I could see, and Adya just said, wanted to say, well, or he just said, right, that's the level. That's one level of development. The next level is no mind. It just happens.
Everything is just happening. The idea that you're in charge of it is nonsense.
And it's always like that anyway. It's just a matter of recognizing.
That's right. This is always the way it is.
Can I go back to something you brought up? Talking about freedom. Okay, so normally, like in this culture, we think about freedom as freedom to do stuff. Freedom to this, freedom to that, freedom to the other thing. In a spiritual context, freedom means freedom from the belief that I am the doer, freedom from the belief that I am the body, freedom from the belief that I am a separate being, freedom from the belief that I am the thinker, freedom from the belief that I feel things.
That you're in charge.
Could you comment on this?
No, I agree with all that. That's all. I mean, that's just, yes. Freedom from you. Freedom from the belief that you're doing this, that you're in charge. And that then you have to worry about being in charge. You have to be careful about it. You can't make a mistake. And what if you do? You should really be very concerned to not make a mistake. I mean, all of this is just layer upon layer of obsessive rumination that does nothing but make us fearful and inhibited and cautious. So that's... Yes, I agree. Those are all
freedom to act spontaneously.
Freedom to be yourself, really. I mean, what is this about? It's about being who you really are.
You need every moment
that appears in the absence. And that appears when there's freedom from old things that we, you know, believe, like our worldview, basically.
Yeah.
You know, I just said, like, you realize that every thought has a whole worldview behind it. It's not just a thought.
Mm-hmm.
It implies an entire worldview.
That's right. And no thoughts are our thoughts. Thoughts are impersonal. They seem like they're ours, but they're really not ours. That's why they have a worldview. It's a program, real, I call it. It's like, just seems like it's mine. It really isn't. It's like PB says the ego isn't personal. He doesn't say it exactly like that, but the ego's made up of conditioned programs, beliefs, assumptions. It's not an entity, and it's not personal. It's impersonal. It's an aggregate of thoughts and beliefs and convictions and assumptions.
It's one thing I observed about psychology in general was that it seemed like the process of psychology is prying people off of personal identification with what's going on, and referring it to more of an objective frame of reference rather than depersonalizing. So it might be the archetypes of the collective unconscious, or it might be whatever, it might be your astrology chart, or it might be something, but it's basically to get you, you know,
not take it personal.
Right.
Yeah, a lot of good cognitive behavioral psychology is exactly that. Looking for alternate explanations for why somebody did something. Maybe it's not that they didn't smile at you in the hallway because they hate you, or you said something to them the other day that offended them. Maybe they have a headache. You know, maybe they had a fight with their wife. I don't know. Those are just common, those are good common sense things. Loosening your grip on your current way of perceiving the world. How you perceive and interpret everything is just one way, and it's just conditioned. It's not real. Unless it's coming out of this empty no-mind thing, then it's real. But how we normally perceive and interpret everything is just a program that's running through us.
I had a glimpse once. We went to see the Dalai Lama up in Buffalo, ten years ago. And we had a personal interview with a small group of people. And it was nice, and then I went home and I was going to sleep that night, and I was looking at my thoughts going by as I was falling asleep, and it seemed like all of these thoughts were coated with this kind of wax or something, and the wax was, it seemed to refer to a person, like they all seemed to point back, like, you're having this thought, this thought is about you. But then I realized that that was sort of like a machine or something, and that really the same awareness that looks at a tree here is the same awareness that's looking at the thoughts, and it's really impersonal. And it's just the mind's deduction that because some things like sensations and thoughts and feelings seem personal, that there must be a person there. But it's really the same awareness. Regardless of what your experience is, it's completely impersonal. It's just sort of the mind's, I mean, that Kevin's the mind figured that out, you know, because it's a useful idea when you're crossing the street or interacting with people, but really, it's a fiction of the mind. That there's a person is a logical deduction, but it's still a mental construct.
It's a great realization. Because you're having thoughts and beliefs and opinions and feelings and sensations, doesn't mean there's a you having one. It just means they're occurring. They are occurring. But that's it. Anything else is added.
You know, I just want to comment that makes a distinction between the ego and conditioning. And I was just thinking how like resistance like is seemingly, it's not that I take things as I, as like, mm-hmm. I'm so aware that that's a fiction, but there seems to be some underlying resistance to what is, and it feels like it's not from. It must be an embedded thought, or must be something. It's deeply
embedded. It's below consciousness. It's self-protective. There's a belief in there that you got to protect yourself, and that's the resistance. But it doesn't mean it's conscious, or you can get at it consciously. I've seen people who really deprogrammed, deconditioned, let go of an awful lot of their beliefs, but the body still has lots of beliefs. The body, that's especially true with trauma. Like, even if you're no longer believing somebody is out to get you, or somebody's trying to harm you, or something like that, if you've had assault in the past, the body and the sensations and the feelings can still very much react out of fear. There's many levels of deprogramming that have to go on.
So that deprogramming, let's say, looking at that, just like you would look at a thought,
yes.
But this is not really a thought.
It's a sensation or a feeling.
It's a sensation, so it's sort of the same mechanism when you just,
right.
It's not you. I mean, it's not, even if it's
well,
felt.
Well, it has
like
its own validity, but it's not, the interpretation the mind gives to it is not going to be accurate. It's very much like a flashback, you know, in terms of post-traumatic stress disorder, that kind of understanding. And we all are like that, everyone.
This guy, Francis Lucille, says that there's certain tropes, certain things in the personality are actually embedded in the body, and that he uses a special form of yoga which incorporates I guess you would call it mindfulness or wholeness into it, to loosen up the, you know, memories that are embedded in the body, which go to constitute part of the ego, which you can't get at through thinking.
Right. There's a lot of trauma that is very hard to release with any kind of conscious deliberate stuff, no matter what you do. But it can be released through, say, movement. There are many things that can get at it, but whatever he's doing sounds like a good idea to me. Let me just read something here. This is, everything I'm reading to you is just the first chapter, What is the Short Path? So I do recommend, if you don't have the book, you get it, take a look at it. He says here, this is the concept which governs the short path, that he is in the stillness of central being all the time, whether he knows it or not. That he has never left and can never leave it. Isn't that what we're just talking about? And this is so, even in a life past in failure and despair. You are one with the presence of God all the time, whether you see it or not, or know it or not. It is going to be a happier life if you start recognizing it. You start noticing it.
And then you notice that the universe responds.
That's right.
You see these amazing things.
When you let go of trying to control everything, then this other way takes over. This other something, intelligence, he calls it the oversight. And this other way knows things you can't know and don't know. So when you surrender to that, then really miraculous things start to happen.
Consciousness appearing as the person seeks itself. This is its quest. But when it learns and comprehends that it is itself the object of that quest, the person stops not only seeking outside himself, but even engaging in the quest itself. Henceforth, he lets himself be moved by the oversight's flow.
That's what I mean by acting out of my mind, or speaking out of my mind. The oversight manifests through you without sort of the interference of the imaginary you who's trying to control things.
Isn't it really what you're saying? It's like since the ego conditioning is a fiction, it's a fiction, that it's actually really happening, that you are acting from your older self anyway, and it's just that the suffering is actually the believing in that it isn't, that you just don't recognize the older self. It's what, that's the whole thing. It's like it's happening though. Everything that you do is coming from the older self.
Yeah.
And you just don't recognize it.
Yeah, everything else is a fiction.
Yes, like your life is taking place in this gigantic mirror in front of you, and you're totally absorbed with the activities of the beings and yourself and interactions, when in fact you're basically just comprehending the whole thing, what the whole thing takes place in.
Let me just read one more thing, because I mean, I didn't see anything in what I read that is at odds with how I see it. I mean, I like that. I don't read too many people that I don't disagree with something. I want to quibble, but this is the average spiritual aspirant is unduly self-centered. I mean, you could say everybody's unduly self-centered, right? And we're all way too self-centered. This is because he's so preoccupied with his own development, his own self-correction, his own spiritual needs, that he tends to forget a vitally important truth. This is that the last battle to be fought on the quest, the battle which brings the ego finally and fully under the over-self's rule, is reflected to a lesser extent in the earlier battles. This battle cannot possibly be won by the aspirant himself for the very good and sufficient reason that the ego is not willing to commit suicide, or to put it another way, is unable to lift itself onto a plane of non-existence. I've said over and over, this last step is taken by God or by grace. You can't do it. No matter what you do, no matter how hard you work at it, no matter how much you see through things, no matter how much you uncondition and free up yourself and this last thing has to take place of its own. And he says, final victory can only come by the bestowal of grace from the over self, which alone can effect a seeming miracle. To attract this grace, the seeker needs to turn away from his self-centeredness to what is its utter opposite, preoccupation of the over self. So the final step, David Hawkins said, the final step is taken by God. So you can do things that bring you to the precipice, and that's good to do.
Ram Dass used to say you can clear the runway to allow it to land.
Grace is an accident. You can make yourself accident.
Right. You can make grace seeming, apparently, it seems like you can make it more, you can make yourself more attractive to it.
Get involved in a bad love relationship.
Right.
Get addicted to something.
Yeah.
Well, what I like about this teacher in India, he says, the intellectual understanding that you can't do it is itself, if you're really convinced, he says, mm-hmm. now challenge it all you want. Mm-hmm. But once you really understand intellectually that you can't do it yourself, mm-hmm. that's enlightenment. Really in your gut.
Yeah, it has to not be an intellectual. It has to be a felt knowing.
Yeah.
It has to be a direct,
he needs a knowledge.
An absolute certainty that comes from the inside out.
Yeah.
Then that is the same thing as awakening, because you're seeing it as it is. That's how it is. And there's no need for it to be any different. Everything is welcomed and embraced exactly as it is, including that. There's absolutely no sense that something could be better or even different. It just is what it is. Anything else?
It just came out and said you could feel that, but it could be devoid of love. Like I was just what the word that came was by Katie's loving what is. So it's like you could see things as they are, but it could be empty. It could have that emptiness without that love, and that would seem like
It sounds conceptually like that could be true, but experientially, it's not the way I experience it. I don't leave anything out, including love. I mean, it's all included. Everything is here right now. It's only the mind that abstracts things and says, not this, but that. So.
But I meant the felt sense of love.
Like, yeah,
there is a felt sense. Right,
that is included. All of it's included. Unless it's not. I mean, for some people, maybe it isn't. But.
The intimacy with the 10,000 things is intimacy. It's love. It's like love. And it's not quite the same as, you know, when the 20 year old man in love, but it's kind of benevolent, well wishing.
The fully embodied awareness is loving. Totally present. It's here it is.
Not only that, it's what you've been looking for through everything. The relationships, the work, the spiritual path, just one thing. Let's see, I have another one. We haven't done yet. While the dream is still continuing, he cannot help taking its scenes and figures as being quite real. But if someone rings a bell until he awakens from the dreaming state, he will then see that both the scenes and the figures were mere figments of his own imagination. In a sense, the teacher of philosophy acts as this awakener did, except that he directs his efforts to the sense-deceived consciousness of everyday life. So, basically, as you wake up from a dream, so a certain aspect of self-realization is waking up from the waking state, from your life, and seeing that it's a secondary reality. So I like doing it. And so he has another quote, which is interesting. He says, well, you need a teacher at two different intervals in your life. You need a teacher when you start out on the long path to define the long path for you and introduce you to it. And then you need another teacher for the short path, because it's really a rerouting of the spiritual path in a new direction. And he said, but outside of that, I would just stay independent. I mean, outside of those two brief intervals, you know, generally go your own way and, you know, don't join an ashram and all that stuff.
That was him. He was very independent.
Yeah, he was.
Usually you don't need to. I don't see that. Unless you do. Be a light unto yourself. Sooner or later, you have to figure this out yourself anyway.
So it was a fun book to work on. But, I love these quotes.
I kind of steeped them.
Yeah.
Thank you for doing the book and bringing it to us.
Well, really, it was the machinery of Wisdom's Gold Run and their publishing arm and their financial support that made it a reality.
Takes a village.
Yeah, very much.
It does. It's
our,
yeah.
So, Mark, where did you guys dig up these quotes? I mean, is there a huge database, you know, that's searchable? There's stuff in your own readings? Or?
Well, they came from quotes that I posted on Wisdom Out.
Okay, you found those?
Used to be the way the Yahoo groups worked. You could go review all of the quotes that you posted. So when Randy said, why don't you try and put together a book? Basically, what I did was I went to Wisdom Hill and I would take a month worth of quotes and I'd say, this is good. No, this
okay, these out. Quotes that you originally posted, did they come from the published philosophic volumes, from your own readings?
From the electronic database? Edition of the notebooks,
uh-huh.
Where you can do stuff like type in a keyword like consciousness or non-dual or liberation.
Okay, searchable.
Right, yeah. That's sort of how I did it.
And then you and Jeff sort of sorted through them all. I said, let's use that one, yes, no.
Right, he cut down the book to like a third of its original size, saying it wasn't marketable on the original.
People sat around with computers all over the place, typing in all these little scraps of paper they had in shopping bags all over the place.
Yeah, right. And then they finally put together a disc, right, a CD-ROM. So they had all of the quotes were already typed up and organized on one CD-ROM.
It's a lot of them. There's like tens of thousands of them, right?
Well, they sold that CD-ROM.
Yeah. It wasn't a big seller, but they did do it.
Right, but it's very searchable.
And then they put the online one, which is the one I use now.
But yeah, like trunks full of these things, right? These little scraps of paper they've been, you know, writing these insights on for decades upon decades.
Yeah. Yes.
Well.
It's fun.
Why wouldn't
always inspire me?
It's surfaced, and now it's out there.
Right.
Now, like when does it show up on Amazon?
I forgot about it. Do something else.
When does it show up on Amazon?
I think next month. I think the release date's September.
Okay.
Do you know if there will be an Audible version?
But you can get a copy here today, right, Elliot? And we have copies for people who want to buy them today.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. They're in the back of my
okay.
Car. Okay. For $12. You said $12.
$12.
So we're going to stop. We thank Mark Sorrell for coming and people from Wisdom's Gold.
Thank you.
Thank you
for listening to me.